along the coast down to St David's Head. There are little bays and quiet harbours that must have given welcome shelter to many a pilgrim in the old days. Now, these harbours were once thriving little ports, each with its lime kiln and the fishing boats. But now they're places for holidays and for yachting, although don't forget this is a very, very wild coast for sailors. There's even a cove where it's said that the last mermaid was seen on these rocks, seen by two local fishermen, and they were innocent enough to report it. But my route now took me inland. I came past this stone where pilgrims resolved to fast until they reached St. David's. But despite this, my spirits were high as I moved coastward.
I'd splash out in the water like a shrimp that was wild. They'd buy me wreaths of roses to deck me boyish brow. They'd tickle me down all over. Oh, I wish they'd do it now. Oh, I wish they'd do it now.
My goodness, I didn't realize I was singing that rather unpilgrim-like song. It's an old Gower folk song. But it did help me up over this high crag of Penberry, one of the last hills that the pilgrims climbed before they at last glimpsed the wild rocky peninsula on which St. David stands, and they fell under the spell of this rare land. You know, I didn't want to go straight to the cathedral. Instead, I went first to the nearby crag of Cligir Boya.
Well, I wanted to pause here because I think it's the best spot I know to get the whole atmosphere of this lonely peninsula in which the little city of St. David stands. All around you are places associated with the old legends of the saint. Among these strange outcrops of rock of immemorial age, over there is St. Nunn's Well, the spot where St. David's mother gave birth to him, and the well has flown ever since, they say. And over there, Ramsey Island, where St. Justinian, a friend of St. David's, retired from the wilds of this world and used a giant axe to hack a causeway away between himself and the sins of the world. He was martyred, but never mind. Celtic saints always have a trick up their sleeves, so he carried his head under his arm, came back to the mainland, and there is a little ruined chapel in his memory ever since. And, of course, St. David himself. This place is known as Cligir Boya. It was the stronghold in the Dark Ages, way back in the mists of time, about the 6th century, of the chieftain called Boya, who ruled this part of the world. And when St. David settled in the Valley of Roses, as they called the little valley where St. David's now stands, Boya was furious. St. David's presence was distracting him. All sorts of tricks they tried to move the saint, including sending the maids to perform, as the old chronicler rather charmingly and naively says, lascivious acts in order to tempt the monks. However, St. David's sweetness and sanctity conquered all. Boya was discomfited. They've had excavations here in the past, and they have found traces of the old Dark Ages fort. But here, you look beyond the fort, over the hummocks of rock of immemorial age, the oldest rocks in Britain, pre-Cambrian, and there, peeping up among them, is the tower of the cathedral of my journey's end. But once you're inside this enclosure, in this secret valley steeped in the sun, all things seem possible. And I look up to the right now, to the gateway. Down from it come the flight of steps known as the 39 Articles. It was an act of faith in my youth, as a small boy, that if you ran down them, you counted them as 38. If you came up them, 39. And children still do it now.
How many did you get?
I got 29, Lewis.
I got 30.
I've counted wrongly then.
Well, I never come into this cathedral without a shock of delighted surprise. It's all so strange and totally different from any other cathedral I know. The great Norman nave here, the huge pillars, the arches, and high above, the marvellous fretted roof. It's a Tudor roof full of lovely oak work. And the tombs, of course, any amount of tombs here of everybody who seemed to mean somebody in Welsh history. Bishop Gower, who built the bishop's palaces here. Giraldus Cambrensis, Gerald the Welshman, who wrote the wittiest and most informative account we have of life in the 12th century in Wales. And the great screen for the choir. And the choir behind it, full of 15th century woodwork. And the misery chords. You can't resist turning the seats up and you get a lovely glimpse into the wit and humour of the Middle Ages. And you go on then and you come to the tomb in front of the high altar of Edmund Tudor, the father of Henry VII. And when I look at it, I can always remember the rather charmingly irreverent entry in the Reverend Francis Kilvert's diary. He came here in the time when the cathedral was being reconstructed in the 1870s, 100 years ago. There was a crack in the tomb and he couldn't resist it. As he said, we poked our umbrellas in and stirred the royal earth. It felt very much like common clay. And then beyond, the shrine of St. David's himself. And this is the old shrine of St. David's. And here is the opening where the pilgrims came and placed their offerings in the Middle Ages. I've come at last to Holy Trinity Chapel behind the high altar, the last stage of my pilgrimage. And here before me is the open casket which may contain the actual bones of St. David himself. I touch it, and let me make my pilgrim's prayer that St. David will always keep in his gentle care this lovely land of Wales.